Good morning, Lone Star family. We are so excited that you are joining us this morning via Facebook Live online church. We just want to encourage you that get your family around, grab your Bibles. We've got our worship team here this morning with us, and we're going to enter into worship. So just enter in with us just like you would here at church. Amen. Hallelujah.
Again, we're glad you tuned in with us this morning. You know, we were talking this morning as the few of us gathered here and just excited about the fact that, guess what? The church is not a building, right? The church is people. And so we can have church no matter where we're at. And we're thankful you've tuned in today. We want to welcome you if you've tuned in. If you're not one of our regular attendees and members, we're glad that you've tuned in with us this morning. And we're excited to be able to be with you. Do want to give you a few announcements. So services at the church as well as our Women's Connect right now, everything is postponed, is suspended. Until a later date, we're just kind of waiting out things and seeing what kind of recommendations and things we get going forward and all this. So services are all suspended, but that doesn't mean we're not having service. We may not be meeting in person, but we can still get together here via Facebook. So in that youth, we have a youth group. We have youth pastors, Pastor Joey and Sarah. They're up here on stage with us this morning. They are doing live service on Instagram tonight at 6 p.m. So normally we have youth at 6 p.m. on Sunday nights, and they will be doing a live broadcast on Instagram, and our Instagram is Lone Star Youth. So look up Lone Star Youth on Instagram, and that will be at 6 p.m. tonight with Pastors Joey and Sarah. And then on Wednesday night at 7 p.m., we are also going to have a service. It'll be a short service Wednesday night at 7, but we're excited about that. So we're going to join you midweek via Facebook Live as well. And again, here on our Facebook page, we would love to have you join us on Wednesday night. And then all through the week, we're going to be putting stuff on all of our social media just to encourage you, to connect with you. If you're one of our Lone Star members and you're in need, we put something out the other day, please contact us. Via Facebook. We'd love to be able to help you in any way that we can. So we're also, right, we're doing service just like normal, so we're going to do offering time. Obviously, we're not passing buckets, so there are some different ways that you can give if you'd still like to continue your giving on a regular basis. You can give online at our website, lonestarchurch.org. I think there's some information we're putting up on the page here. Hopefully you can see that. We're doing some new things this morning. But you can go to our website, lonestarchurch.org, and then there is a giving tab. I do want to tell you that if you have any issues with the giving online, we are working with our provider that provides that giving to have some new things going up. Those should be up tomorrow as of Monday. So if you have trouble giving today online, know that that will be, those issues will be taken care of by tomorrow. So you can go to the website anytime and give there as well. You can also mail your gift if you feel more comfortable mailing your gift. Our church address is 6006 State Highway FF, Denver, Missouri 64441. We'll also have that information up as well, and we'll post those things on our Facebook page in case you would like to do that. But it's interesting because it's there is such a panic going on, right? And there's all this discussion, is the government going to send us checks? Are they going to bail us out? Are they going to bail my business out? The thing I want to encourage you in is our trust is not in the government, yeah. Right? We're thankful for whatever happens and what is going on and what they are doing. But our faith is in God. And I want to read you a scripture today as we're talking about our giving. Because there's a lot of controversy. I saw a lot of things online this week about whether churches should still offer or talk about offering or not, with people, some of them out of work, people losing business and things like that. But I want you to see what the Word says. And we're not trying to twist anyone's arm. I just want to show you what the Word says. In Genesis chapter 26, this is the story. This is Isaac, Abraham's son, and in verse 1 of Genesis 26, it says, "Now there was a famine in the land beside the former famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Gerar to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, and the Lord appeared to him and said, 'Do not go down to Egypt. Dwell in the land of which I shall tell you.' He said, 'Stay in this land, and I will be with you, and I will bless you. For to you and to your offspring I will give these lands, and I will establish the oath that I swore to Abraham your father.'" Verse 4 here in Genesis 26, he says, "I will multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven, and I will give to your offspring all these lands, and in your offspring all the nations of earth shall be blessed, because Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws." So God tells Isaac where to go, what to do here in a time of famine. And then you go to verse 12, and look at what it says. And it says, and Isaac, during a time of famine, and Isaac sowed in that land, and he reaped in the same year a hundredfold. The Lord blessed him. And the man became rich and gained more and more until he became very wealthy. And then it talks about all the possessions he had. And so I want to encourage you, Isaac did not hoard his resources during a time of famine, right? We've seen this on the news. You've probably seen it at your local grocery store, at Walmart, at Hy-Vee, wherever you're shopping, of people hoarding things up, right? Isaac did not hoard. God gave us a mind. God gave us wisdom. We want to be wise in what we have. We want to be wise in our giving. But Isaac didn't hoard. Isaac sowed during time of famine. Yeah. Amen. And so during tough times, it's not a time to quit sowing, right, and eating our seed. We always want to make sure we're sowing, because we believe that God is going to use the church as we've reached out to people to help meet needs in areas that those needs need met in our local area, but also to continue sowing into world missions and to reaching other people around the world. And so we're thankful for you and your faithfulness and your seed. And in 2 Corinthians 9, verse 7, it says, purpose in your heart what to give, right? And so we just want to trust that you hear from God in your giving. God is not going to make you be unwise in your giving. Whether your job's been affected, your business has been affected, there's always wisdom there. And so we just encourage you to seek God in your gift. But we thank God, he is our provider, right? The Bible says, my God shall supply all of my needs through his riches and glory through Christ Jesus. And so as you're giving today, right, whether you're going to send your gift in, if you're going to give online, again, remember, some of those things are being updated. That should be taken care of by tomorrow afternoon. However you're giving, right, in your generosity, we're thankful for that. And we're thankful today that God is our provider. So if you've got a seed, right, if you're giving today, you want to hold up your seed, you hold it up and pray over it. I'll pray over it as well. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give, even in times of trouble, Lord. We thank you that we can give. And God, we thank you that you are the God of more than enough. You are our provider. And God, even if we don't have much in our cupboard today, Lord, we thank you that you can multiply what we have. Lord, and you can make it last through all of this. Lord, we thank you that you are the El Shaddai, the God of more than enough. And God, we thank you that you have given seed to the sower. And Lord, no matter what happens in our country, no matter what happens in our lives, Lord, we will never stop sowing into your kingdom. Because God, you'll take that seed and multiply it and pour out upon the sower a harvest of more than enough. God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your provision supernaturally in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. All right, we're going to continue to worship. So you worship with us there at home.
I open up my heart to you. sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do.
Looking around at anything else, at the stuff going on in the world around us. I'm telling you, just like Mary, right? She left all the stuff that she had to do. She left everything and she just came and sat at his feet. Lord, I thank you. There is this morning. I thank you, Lord, there is this morning. There is no distance in the Spirit today. God, wherever people are watching today in their homes, wherever they're at today, Lord, if they're by themselves, if they're with their family, Lord, I thank you right now. I thank you, your presence is in that place. Lord, your presence isn't just limited to this building. God, your presence is in us, and your presence is there. And I thank you right now, God, I thank you right now, there is an anointing of peace that is coming into homes where there's been an absence of peace over the last week or so. God, I thank you right now, peace is being ushered in because we just want you. And God, in your presence, there is peace that passes understanding. God, I thank you right now for that anointing. I thank you for the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you right there, just turn up the volume on whatever you're listening on this morning and just close your eyes. And just start to lift, thank you, Lord. Just start to lift up his name. Just start to lift up the name of Jesus. Just start to lift that up in your homes. Just start to lift that up where you're at with your family, with your children. God, I thank you right now. I thank you right now. God, where there was none, there is now peace. Where there was no joy, there is now joy. God, we rest in you today. The devil, the thief comes but for to steal, kill, and destroy, but you have come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. The devil's a liar. He wants you to be in fear. He wants you to be in panic mode. He wants you to think about what you're going to lose. But here's the thing, guess what? We put it all on the cross. We'd walk away from it all for you, Jesus. There's nothing we possess that is greater than your presence today, Father. And in your presence, there's provision. There is peace. And there is joy unspeakable and full of glory. So today, God, we rest in you. We run to you, our strong tower. We rest under your wings. We take refuge in you this morning. And God, when all the stuff is going on around us and all the things we can read, right now we take a break from that and just, we want to be in your presence today. We're thankful for his presence today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 I'm telling you, God, you know, I was thinking about this and I was reading and seeing posts from a number of other pastors in the area that have never been online before. Facebook Live, that a number of them, and I know all over the country, people that haven't been streaming before, they are online today. So what the devil meant for evil in keeping people from church, keeping people from hearing the word, I believe that we have more people online than we've ever had online for a service today. And I know this is going to be shared. It's going to be watched later. And I'm just believing that where the devil thought he could shut the church up, that we're going to reach more people than we've ever reached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm thankful. Right, we are, if you come to church here, if you've been here, you know Lone Star, we are what's considered a remote church. Right, our location is remote, and it's not, it's off the beaten path. We don't even, and some of you know this, but some of you may not, but we don't even have running water. Right, water, rural water does not come past this church. We have to haul water and pump it into the building. But you know what we do have? We have high-speed fiber optic internet so that we can stream live from a remote location in the country and reach you every single Sunday. We do this every Sunday. I know some of you, maybe you're just tuning in for the first time and you don't know, but we do this every Sunday. We stream live every Sunday, and on a normal Sunday, we have two services at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. We have Linked Up, where we have coffee, bagels, and muffins at 10:30. And so maybe you don't have a church home and you're watching for the first time. You say, hey, when we get back to normal, and it's going to be soon, hallelujah, that I'm looking for a church home, man, we'd love to have you come be with us. We're going to share out of the Word today. Because what I know is that in the world right now, there is a lot of uncertainty. There's a lot of uncertainty in the world right now, right? There are people that don't know, when am I going back to school? When am I going back to work? Am I still going to have a job? Is my job laying people off? Is my job essential? Because I thought that my job was pretty important, but is my job essential? And right, there's all this uncertainty with the stock market, with people's retirements, with the price of goods. There's uncertainty whether you're going to be able to find toilet paper in the near future. There's uncertainty all around us, but we have a sure word. Amen. We have a solid foundation in the Word. I want to look at that a little this morning before we get into some more things. But go with me to Psalms 18. And I want to encourage you, right? Get your Bible. Yes. Write down these scriptures. Because this morning's message, right? This word is more than just for today, right? Get these scriptures and take advantage. Take advantage instead of looking at everything negatively, because it's real easy to do. Our flesh always tends towards the negative. We're going to go to Psalm 18 and look at verse 31. But take advantage of this time, right? I know a number of you've got your kids at home. You've finished the first week. You've got two more weeks to go with them out of school, right? Maybe you're out of work and you're at home a lot and you're just around each other all the time. And you think, what are we going to do with all this time? Take some time to turn off Netflix. Take some time to put the board games and the puzzles away. Take some time to put all that stuff away. And I was thinking about this morning. Take some time to spend in the Word with your family every single day. Because we all know when life is going at full speed and normal, and we have school and we have work and we have practices and we have recitals and we have ball games and all these things, that we find it hard to find 10 minutes to sit down with our kids and just read a Bible scripture, right, and talk about the Word. So I want to encourage you, take 10 minutes, right, with your kids at home, and they're probably not going to enjoy it, right, at first, because, oh, we got to all get together. Yes, we're all going to be in the same room at the same time, and they're going to try to tell you that's not social distancing, but you're all right, right, and spend some time together. Read the Word, pray. Let your kids know, right? In times of uncertainty, most of your kids, if they're old enough to go to school, they see the news. They see things on social media, and they understand all this panic and all this hysteria that's around this. So spend some time with your kids and letting them know, you know what? People are in fear and people are in worry, but we're not, because our trust is in God, and we have a sure foundation. Amen? In Psalm 18 and verse 31, hallelujah. You can amen at home. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. But look at what it says. It says, for who is God except the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? He is a rock. Amen. Psalm 62 and verse 2. Amen. Look, it says, he only, talking about God, is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. Right? So it tells us, Ephesians 2:19 tells us that Jesus is our foundation, right? The Gospels tell us Jesus is the cornerstone in which everything else was built. So in all this uncertainty, you know what we have? We've got a rock. We've got a firm foundation, right? My feet are not planted on sand. They're not planted on things that aren't sure. My feet are planted on the rock of the Word. Amen. And it doesn't matter what wind blows. It doesn't matter what storms come. That rock will never be washed away. That rock will stand, right? The Bible says that God, let God be true and every man a liar. God's word is true. It is firm. He is faithful. Amen. I want to read you this story. This is a story about John G. Lake. And I kind of mentioned this last week, but I want you to see this story. And so John G. was a missionary in South Africa from 1908 to 1913. And while he was there, there was an outbreak of the bubonic plague, right? And John G. Lake and his team were caring for the sick, and they were burying the dead. And at some point, Britain sent a ship with medical supplies and some doctors to assist him. And the doctors asked Reverend Lake, they said, how do you protect yourself from this deadly plague? And his answer was this. Listen to this. It's Romans 8:2. This was his answer. He said, I believe the law of the spirit of life has set me free from the law of sin and death. Right? That's Romans 8:2. The law of the spirit of life has set me free from the law of sin and death. And he said, as long as I walk in the light of that law of the spirit of life, no joy will attach itself to me. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Right? And so Romans 8:2 speaks of Jesus' work of salvation, right? Bringing the life of the Spirit of God to us and freeing us from the law of sin and everything evil that comes in the world through sin. Death, sickness, disease, right? Addiction, spiritual death, early physical death, poverty, right? That's the law of sin, but we've been set free from that. Right, the law of the spirit of life has set us free from that. And so the doctors were not convinced, and so John G. Lake insisted that they do a microscopic experiment on him. He said, take some of the foam from the lungs of a person who died with bubonic plague. He goes, and put it under a microscope. And when they did, the disease was still alive and bouncing around. And he said, now put it on my hand and put it under the microscope. And when they did, the disease cells instantly died. Why? Because the law of the spirit of life has set me free from the law of sin and death. So here's the deal. I don't care what science says. The law, right, of the spirit of life has set us free from the law of sin and death. Amen. Amen. And now is not the time to be afraid. Now is not the time to shrink back. Now is the time for the church to rise up. Amen. And because I was thinking about this. The world is watching us. The world is watching us. I read a pastor the other day. He said, I'm not bringing up a bunch of pansies. I'm bringing up revivalists. Yeah, amen. And it doesn't mean we're not wise, and it doesn't mean we don't heed certain things. But the world is watching. How will the church react to this? How will we react to this virus? Will we be like John G. Lake? And right, we're like, man, we believe God is bigger than this. Right, and I'm not talking about being foolish. I'm talking about being wise, but being wise in God and in His Word. Hebrews, I want you to see this. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 39. Hebrews 10, 39. Listen to what the writer of Hebrews says here. Are you listening this morning? I'm preaching louder than you're amening this morning. Praise the Lord. I do have a handful of folks here to give me something this morning. I want to read Hebrews 10 and verse 39. I want to read this in the English Standard Version and then also out of the Passion Translation. But listen to this. The English Standard, Hebrews 10, 39 says, but we are not of those who shrink back. Say, I'm not of those who shrink back.
I'm not of those who shrink back.
Right? We're not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but we are of those who have faith and persevere through their souls, right? Preserve their souls. The Passion Translation of that same verse says, but we are certainly not those who are held back by fear and perish, right? I'm not going to be held back by fear and perish.
Amen.
I'm not going to be held back by fear. No, who are we? We are among those who have faith and experience true life.
Come on.
Amen. This is not the time to shrink back. It's not the time to cower in the corner. No, it's the time to rise up and push back against the enemy. Right, last week, a week ago, our president declared a national day of prayer, and I saw churches all over the place. I friends of mine, churches, and people that I follow, churches in our local area that were praying. Right, and here's the thing. Right, our prayers aren't woe is me, God help us this. No, we're going to be on the offense. We're going to push this disease, this virus, out of our nation. We're going to push it out. Right? I'm not waiting on some scientist to save me. I'm not waiting on the government to save me. Why? Because Jesus already saved me. Right? By his stripes, Peter said, we were healed. I'm not waiting on healing to come. It already came through Jesus over 2,000 years ago. I'm just going to obtain and possess by faith what I already have. Amen? And I'm not shrinking back. I'm pushing coronavirus out. I'm going to push it out of my house. I'm going to push it out of my body. I'm going to push it out of my family's body. I'm going to push it out of my community. I'm going to push it out of my state. And if the church would rise up, oh, we're so afraid. No, I'm not afraid. I'm in faith.
Amen.
And I'm going to push it out.
Amen.
Right? It is time for the church to rise up and attack.
That's right.
You say, how do I do that? We do it in the spirit. We do it through prayer. We do it through preaching gospel. We do it through not sharing all this scary stuff, right? I'm not going to take a picture every time I go to the store of an empty toilet paper aisle. I'm not going to take a picture every time that the potatoes are gone. I'm not going to say, oh my gosh, you can't buy flour anywhere. You can't get potatoes anywhere. I'm not going to do that. Why? Because all I'm doing is I'm throwing fuel on the fire of fear, right? So Christians, right, if you're listening to me right now, quit throwing fuel on the fire of fear, right? And I am so impressed with the people of this church because I have watched post after post of people posted Bible verses and scripture and we're in faith and not in fear, right? So let's start attacking this thing. Right? The battlefield of your mind is where things are won and lost. And we're going to talk about that Wednesday night. My wife's actually going to talk about that Wednesday night at 7 p.m. when we go live on Wednesday about your mind and your thoughts. Because right now, the devil wants to, and he's trying to work overtime in your head. Amen. Don't let him do that. Don't let him move in. Right? Brother Hagin used to say this. He said, you can't control whether a bird flies over your head or not, but you can control whether he makes a nest in your hair. Right? And you say, well, what does that have to do with anything? You can't control the thoughts that come across your screen, the thoughts that come through your mind, but you can control whether you think on those thoughts or not.
Right,
amen? No, I'm not going to shrink back, right? I'm certainly not those who are held back by fear and perish. No, I'm among those who have faith and experience true life.
Yes.
Amen? Right? The Bible talks about mixing what you heard with faith. Right? That there are people... Right? There are people, thank you, Lord. We're going to go a little different direction here for a moment. There are people that hear the word, but don't mix what they hear with faith. Amen? Mixing what you hear with faith, that's here in Hebrews. I'm going to find the scripture here real quick. Hallelujah. Hebrews 4 and verse 2. Now listen to this, Hebrews 4:2. Amen. It says, for indeed the gospel, or the good news, right? You've been hearing a lot of bad news recently, but it says, for indeed the gospel, the good news, was preached to us as well as to them. What is the good news, right? Well, the good news we know is Jesus Christ. And so the good news, what's good news to a sinner? That Jesus paid the price for your sin, right? What's good news to someone who's going to die and go to hell? That you've got that someone else paid that price, and you've got a reprieve from God Almighty, and that you've been set free, right? What's good news to the one who's sick? That Jesus is a healer. What's good news to the one who needs things, who's in lack? That God's a provider, right? All these things, who God is, who Jesus is, right? That's good news. So it says, for indeed the gospel, the good news was preached to us as well as to them. So think about this, good news was preached to a number of people, right? Good news was preached to a number of people, just like we're reaching a number of people this morning. Right? You're hearing good news this morning. But it's what you do with the word, right? Look at what it says. But the word which they heard, the good news they heard, did not profit them, did not benefit them. So it's possible for you to sit in a church service, for you to watch a church service on television, for you to watch a church service on Facebook, and you hear good news, you get a little excited about it, hallelujah, but it doesn't profit you, right? There are a lot of people, and here's where the blame gets put. Why didn't the word work for me? Well, obviously, God didn't want it to work for me. But that's not what it says here, right? It says the word did not profit them. Why? Not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. So many are going here, right? That it's time for us to advance against this virus, advance against the enemy, take back what the enemy stole, right? Push back with the gospel, push back with the Spirit of God, push back with the Word of God, push back through prayer, push back spiritually, push back, right? The violent taketh by force, the Bible said, right? I'm not just going to sit here and take it. We're going to push back against the enemy, right? The devil's a bully, and he will take as much as you let him take. The word of God was preached. The good news was preached. Jesus is my healer. Jesus is my Savior, right? Jesus, my God's my provider. But the thing is, it won't work for you unless you do something with it. What do you got to do? You got to mix it with faith, right? Those who hear it have to mix it with faith, right? What is faith? Faith is believing, right? How does faith come? The Bible tells us in Romans 10, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Faith is simply believing that what God said is true. What God said is true. And then, right, we're not just hearers only, says James, but we're also doers of the word, right? I'm not just going to hear this good news. I'm going to put this good news into action, right? I'm ready to not shrink back. I'm ready to push forward in these things. Amen? Go with me to Philippians chapter 3 and verse 14. Hallelujah. Look at what Paul writes here. Philippians 3 and verse 14. Hallelujah. Look at what he says. He said, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ. Right? So Paul often uses athletics in what he talks about. He talks about races. Here he says, I press towards the goal. Think about a runner at the end of a race, right? A close race. What do? They lean out towards it. Right? So what are we going to do? We're not shrinking back. We're leaning out into God. We're leaning out over that precipice of things. We're leaning into Him. Right? I'm pressing towards the goal. I'm pressing towards the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. God told Joshua, right? Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. Think about this. Right? Moses had just died. And now Joshua's going to take his place as the leader of Israel. And listen to what he says, actually verses 8 and 9, Joshua 1, 8 and 9. He says, this book of the law, what's he talking about? He's talking about the word, right? At this point, that's the Bible they had. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. What needs to be coming out of our mouth right now? The word, right? But you shall meditate in it day and night. Man, I'm thinking on the word. I'm speaking the word. I'm believing the word. I'm trusting the word. Why? Because it's a rock. It's a firm foundation. Amen. And he says that you may observe to do. So I'm not just thinking about it. I'm not just speaking it. I'm doing it. So you may be able to observe to do according to all that's written in it. For then, when I'm speaking it, when I'm thinking on it, when I'm doing it, right? Then, when I'm thinking it, when I'm speaking it, when I'm doing it, when I'm thinking it, when I'm speaking it, when I'm doing it, when I'm thinking it, when I'm speaking it, when I do it, then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you, verse 9, Joshua 1, be strong and of good courage. I'm going to tell you right now, you know what God wants you to know right now? Be strong and of good courage. I don't care what the news says. I don't care what you read online. I don't care what someone posted. Right, there are all, right, I've talked about uncertainty. There's all kinds of things going on. Right, people say, I heard my neighbor has corona. I heard his dog has corona. I heard the people, the guy checks you out at Walmart has corona. He checked me out the other day. I heard someone coughed on the machine where you put your credit card, and I might have corona, right? No, be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid. That's a choice. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. I'm not going to be afraid. I'm not going to be afraid. Well, what if I got to get out and go to the store? I'm not going to be afraid. I choose to not be afraid. Why? For the Lord my God is with me wherever I go. He's with me. He's with me. He protects me. Amen. And I'm pushing forward. I'm pushing forward. I'm not sitting back. I'm not sitting back and waiting. I'm telling you, so many people, they're just sitting back and waiting for something bad to happen. They're just, it hasn't been found in our area yet, but just wait. There hasn't been a case in our county yet, but just wait. There hasn't been a case in our part of the state, but just wait. Just wait for what? For the devil to do something, or wait for God to do something?
Come on.
Amen? Because when God shows up, things happen. Amen? People get healed. People get delivered. Right, Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and of good courage. Do not fear nor be afraid of them. For the Lord your God, He is the one who goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. I'm not afraid of this virus. I'm not afraid of this virus. I'm not afraid of it for myself. I'm not afraid of it for my family. I'm not afraid of it for my nation. Well, you just don't know enough about it. Well, you don't know enough about my God. Amen. I don't need to know enough about it. Amen. I need to know more about who my God is than what this virus does. And I trust the Bible more than I trust some guy with a PhD or a doctorate, right? I trust the Bible more than I trust some talking head on television, someone tweeting, someone posting on Facebook or Instagram. Amen. No, be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid of them, for the Lord your God, he is the one who goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage. Amen. Lo, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. I choose to fear no evil. Go over with me to Ephesians chapter 2. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 14. Right? I know there has been a lack of this in the world, a lack of this sometimes in our life. But look at what it says. It says, for he himself, talking about Jesus, says, he is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, right? He is our peace, right? You say, I don't have any peace? Then, man, just spend time with him. Just spend time in him. Why? Because he is my peace, right? I can just rest in him. I can just sit at his feet. I can just, I mentioned this, and I put a link to this on my personal page. We'll do something on the church page this week. But one of our instructors at Bible College at Rhema, his name is Keith Moore. And he has a church in Branson. He has a church in Florida. And his website, More Life Ministries, M-O-O-R-E, More Life Ministries. If you go there, there's a place that says free messages. And if you click on that, there's a place after that that says music. And if you scroll down that music page, there's an album that he has called The Peace of God. And it's got, I think, 10 or 12 songs, The Peace of God. And you can download that for free. He always has all his materials are free. You can download that for free. And I'm telling you, that album, it's, I don't know, 20 years old. But it has gotten my wife and I through some rough times in our life. Yes. Just playing that on a continuous loop. We played that for our children when they were young at night. Every night we would put that album on in their room and we would play that. Peace of God. And I'm telling you, if you've been struggling with fear, if you've been struggling with a lack of peace in your life, start to get in his word, start to spend time in prayer, download that album and listen to that. Put it on in your house in the background when your kids are doing homework, when your kids are playing games, and just play that. On a constant, when you go to sleep at night, just play that. And I'm telling you, there's an anointing on that music, right? Maybe you have some favorite worship music that you like. Play that. Put that on and play that through your house throughout the day. I'm telling you, God will usher that peace in. Yes. Why? Because he is our peace. Yes. He is our peace. The psalmist talks about peace in Psalm 85 and verse 8. I know we're giving you a lot of scripture. But I want you to have the word, because I want you to be equipped this week, right, as you're going through stuff in your life, Psalm 85 and verse 8, I want you to be equipped with the word of God, right? The Bible tells us, right, Paul tells us that we are to put on the full armor of God, right? You know that scripture talking about the full armor of God? It's in Ephesians 5, right, Nicole? And it talks about, right, helmet of truth, right, and the breastplate, and the buckle, right, and the shield of faith. But then it says, pick up the sword, right? The only offensive weapon is the sword, right, which is the word of God. So think about this. We want to be on the offense this week. What's the only offensive weapon we have as Christians? It is the sword of the Spirit. It is the word of God. When Jesus was tempted, what did he do every time he was tempted? He said, it is written. So when you're tempted to get in fear this week, when you're tempted to get out of peace this week, what do? You say, no, I'm going to pick up my sword. I'm going to pick up my Bible, and it is written, devil. Right? The devil say, well, it's written on CNN, or it's written on Yahoo, or it's written on Facebook, or it's written on Twitter, it's written on Instagram. It's written in the, no, let me tell you, devil, because the devil tried that with Jesus, right? And he's an idiot. He's a dummy, and he uses the same tricks over and over, right? And he'll try the same thing with you, and he'll say, no, it is written. And he'll try to give you a piece of the word and something else and try to scare you. Well, he did that with Jesus. You know what Jesus said? He said, it is also written, devil. Let me tell you, I'm the word made man. Let me tell you what God really meant. Right? Let me tell you what is written. So when you get in fear this week, when your children get in fear, you tell your children, you tell your mind, you tell yourself, no, it is written. Right? I'm going to pick up my sword. I'm going to pick up and attack you, devil. I'm not just waiting for you to get me and protecting myself. I'm going to put on all the armor, but I'm going to pick up my sword, and I'm going to run you out of my house. I'm going to run you out of my county. I'm going to run you out of my state. I'm going to run you out of my country, because it is written. Right? Jesus already defeated you, Satan. He made a show of you openly, and you're under my feet in the name of Jesus. Amen. Psalm 85 and verse 8. Now I'll listen carefully for your voice, talking about listening for God, and wait to hear whatever you say. Let me hear your promise of peace, the message every one of your godly lovers longs to hear. Don't let us in our ignorance turn back from following you. Let me hear your promise of peace. His promise of peace. God has given you a promise of peace. Right in the midst of everything that's going on around you, you have a promise of peace. Amen. Psalm 119 and verse 165. Psalm 119 and 165. Listen to this. It says, great peace. How you know he doesn't just give you a little peace, he gives you great peace. Great peace have those who love your law, and nothing causes them to stumble. Right? Great peace have those who love your law. We have great peace. Great peace. Let's read a couple things from Jesus here in John 14. John 14 and verse 27. Listen to the words of our Savior. John 14, 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Jesus was telling him, look, I'm about ready to leave, and there are things that are going to happen after I'm gone. Some of these things will be tough things. But what's he say? I'm leaving you with something. How do you know he left us with something? He left us with the Holy Spirit, amen. But he says he leaves you with peace. And he said, look, this isn't the world's peace. This is my peace. What kind of peace did Jesus have? Well, think about this. Who was asleep in the boat when the storm came? Jesus. That's the kind of peace he has, the kind of peace that sleeps during a storm, the kind of peace that isn't panicking, the kind of peace that isn't freaking out, right? No, that kind of peace. He says, my peace, I leave with you my peace, amen? And he says, and I'm giving it to you, but I don't give as the world gives, amen? How does the world give? Number one, the world gives in a stingy manner, right? The world doesn't give you an abundance of something, but God does, right? He gives, the Bible says, and abrades not, doesn't hold back anything. He says, then he tells you, you've got something to do. What's he say you've got to do? I've given you my peace. Now here's what you do with his peace. Listen to this. You need to hear this. This is what you do with the peace he's given you. Don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let your heart be afraid. Well, you don't know what's going on. There was a case in my backyard. My neighbor has this. I heard so-and-so had this. Thousands of people in Italy, thousands of people all over the world, right? Don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let your heart be afraid. What's that mean? You have a choice. I'm either going to latch onto the peace of God. I'm going to latch onto the word. I'm going to stand on that rock and choose not to be afraid. Choose, right, not to let my heart be troubled. Or I'm going to give in to the world, give in to fear, and get out of the peace that God has already given me. You choose whether you walk in this peace or not. Right? Your circumstances do not dictate the peace of God in your life. It's already been given to you. Your circumstances can't affect that. Only you making a choice to get out of that peace affects that in your life. I want to read two more scriptures to you in John chapter 16 and verse 33. Jesus again, here before he's about ready to leave this earth, John 16:33. He's talking to his disciples, and he says, "These things have I spoken to you." Right, telling them he's getting ready to leave and things are going to change. He says, "These things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace." He says, in the world, you're going to have trouble. But he says, in me, you're going to have peace. But be of good cheer. Hallelujah. I've overcome the world. Cheer up, folks. Right, you say, what's there to be happy about? Cheer up. Why? Because my God, because Jesus overcame the world. Time to get happy. Amen. Time to get happy. I want to read one last verse, and then we're going to close. Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. Isaiah 26 and verse 3. Listen to what the prophet of God writes. He says, "You will keep in him in perfect peace." Who? Whose mind is stayed on you. Why? Because that person trusts you. You want to have perfect peace? Limit the amount of time you watch the news. Limit the amount of time you're on social media. Limit the amount of time you give to. I'm telling you, if there are people that are posting panic and stuff, hide them. You say, "I don't want to unfriend them." Don't unfriend them. Hide them. Hide them for a month, right? Hide them forever, whatever you want to do. But hide that junk from your eyes. Why? Because God says, right, that there is perfect peace, right? He'll keep me in perfect peace if I keep my mind on him, on his word, on his thoughts, right? On what he says to me, on the rock of my salvation. I'm going to keep my mind there. Amen? Praise the Lord. I'm going to have my wife come up. Hallelujah. I believe that even though we are simply doing this via Facebook, via the internet, that there are people listening that God has something for you. Maybe he's already spoken to you through the word that came forth today, right? Hopefully we've encouraged you in the Lord and given you that word. But I believe that God has some specific things that he wants to do in your life right now. Maybe you're listening and maybe you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe you're listening and you need healing in your body. And you just say, how do these things happen? How do they come? I believe God wants to speak to you right now.
Hallelujah. I agree. You know, something that was on my heart this morning as I was getting around to come here and to do this service and be a part of it was that I believe that there were going to be people watching Lone Star Church via Facebook online that aren't born again. And I believed, and you know I'm talking to you. You tuned in this morning just like, I wonder if there's something that they have for me that they can give for me. We do. We have something for you. And his name is Jesus. Amen. But if you would like to be born again, it's the best decision you'll ever make in your whole entire life. There's no other decision you'll ever make that's greater than this decision ever, ever. And the Bible says that the only way to get into heaven is through Jesus. So if you want to pray this prayer with me right now, I urge you to do this. This truly is a life and death situation. The Bible says when you're not born again, you function and you live in the kingdom of darkness. But it says that when you are born again, you get translated into the kingdom of light. Amen. And can I tell you something? The light is better than the darkness.
Amen.
Amen. Always. Why? Because light always wins. So when you pray this prayer this morning and you make Jesus the Lord of your life, guess what? You become a winner. You Amen. Win just because you are with Jesus. Amen. So say this prayer with me. Say, "Dear Lord Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus.
I confess this morning that I'm a sinner.
I confess this morning that I'm a sinner.
But I believe that Jesus is the Savior.
That Jesus is the Savior.
And that he is the way to the Father.
That he is the way to the Father.
So right now, Lord Jesus. Come into my heart. Make me a new creature. I believe right now. That all things.
Have been made new.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's rejoice
Hallelujah.
With them. Hallelujah.
Thank
we
you,
bless
Lord.
You, Hallelujah. Lord. We glorify you.
Thank
Hallelujah.
You,
I believe that
Hallelujah.
If you prayed that prayer that you
yes,
are born
Lord.
Again, because the Bible says that confession or that it's a belief in your heart and a confession out of your mouth in Romans 10. But I also want to encourage you that if you prayed that prayer, please message us, contact us.
Yeah, send us a direct message.
Yes, send us a direct message. We have materials that we want to get to you. We want to get some things in your hand that will help you with your Christian living. But also, I want to talk just real quickly, because I want to pray with the viewing audience, amen, about everything that's been going on, and especially from a prayerful stance. You know, I met with some ladies Friday morning, and we just prayed in the Spirit about what is going on in our nation. And it's really interesting, because if you looked under a petri dish at the coronavirus, it's so small. It's such a small little thing. But isn't it interesting how something so small can have such a loud voice? And the Lord just really kind of corrected us Friday morning in prayer. And he says, don't let this voice be louder than your voice.
Amen.
My church is to have the loudest voice. My church is to be center stage. And we're to take the word, just like in Ephesians, I was wrong, it wasn't chapter 5, it's chapter 6. But in chapter 6, where it's the sword of the Spirit, you take the word of God, and you let the voice of the word of God have more authority.
Amen.
Have its place in this earth, and the violent taketh by force. There's a passage in the gospel that Jesus said that you, the church, is an occupying force. What does that mean? It means we occupy what Jesus has done in this earth until he comes back.
Amen.
Meaning that when he come out of the grave and he said, all right, come
Thank
on.
You, Lord.
All power and all authority has been given to my church. Now, then he left and he went and he sat in the heavenlies and he's praying for you, but he did the work. Now he expects the church to do the work. Amen.
Amen.
So that means by prayer. So this morning, we're going to pray about this. Amen. And I ask that you join in with me. I've got people here that are going to join in with me by faith in the name of Jesus. So, Father, we lift up this nation. And, Father, right now I draw a bloodline around this nation. Hallelujah. Just like Moses in the Old Testament, when he took the blood and he put it on the doorpost of his house, no evil came into their houses. And every person who had that blood on the doorpost, the evil, the destroyer just went by. I thank you, Lord, that we are drawing a bloodline right now in Jesus' name. And that destroyer can't come past that bloodline. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And, Lord, I lift up the church right now. The church of Jesus Christ. And I pray right now that she would be stronger than she has ever been before. Hallelujah, Lord, I pray that you would strengthen her arms, strengthen her backbone, strengthen her legs, strengthen every part of her. And then I pray for the voice of the church. Lord, that the voice would be loud and weighty. And that, Father, that voice would go places where it is really, really dark, that light would shine where darkness has ruled and reigned. We thank you for the light. We thank you for the word of God that's going forth in this moment. And I thank you, Lord, from this place, this place right now, that the church is brighter and stronger than it has ever been before. Hallelujah. And then we pray for miracles to start to flow in our churches.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That the gifts of the Spirit would begin to flow and manifest in churches. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Because we're the church.
Hallelujah.
And we should be the strongest, loudest force in this nation. Amen.
Thank
Hallelujah.
You.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, I just want to tell you, we're so glad you viewed with us this morning online. Don't forget tonight at 6 p.m. on our Instagram page, Lone Star Youth on Instagram, Pastor Joey and Sarah. It's going to be a good time in youth tonight at 6 p.m. on our Instagram, Lone Star Youth on Instagram. And then Wednesday at 7 p.m. back here on our Facebook page, we will be live as well. We'll be doing that. And we're not stopping. We're not stopping what we do. We may change how we do it, but we're still going to have services. So remember, none of our in-person services right now, they are all suspended for the time being. We'll have more information on that as we go deeper into this. But we are believing with you, right? We're believing with you. We ask you believe with us. We're pushing this out. We're pushing this out of our communities. We're pushing it out of our state, out of our homes, out of this country. Because greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. And we choose to stand on the rock of the word. We will not be moved by what we hear or see. I'm only moved by the word of God and the spirit of God. And when we make that choice and we choose not to be afraid, right? Your mountain needs to hear your voice. Mark 11, 22 through 24. Your mountain needs to hear your voice. This virus needs to hear your voice, right? So church, it's time to stand up and push it out. Again, we're thankful that you are with us today. Remember, you can give by mail. We'll have that information on our Facebook page. You can give online, lonestarchurch.org. If you have any problems with the online giving, we are working with our provider on that, and those should be remedied by tomorrow afternoon. We're so thankful you gave us your time today. I encourage you to share this.